Hi, I'm Abhinav.
I'm Madhu.
Welcome to the Inspiring Idea Podcast. We interview people from across the world and share their life stories and success formulas with our audience. We hope this will inspire you to achieve your dreams. So, let's get the show started. Our guest today is someone who challenged the status quo by leaving his corporate job when he was at his peak to pursue his passion and started his entrepreneurship journey. Please welcome Karthik Vaidyanathan. Karthik is the founder of Let Us Play to Learn, an initiative that enables joyful learning through play for corporates and education institutions. He designs games based on solutions for impactful learning and does workshops. Most recently, he was a speaker at Malaysian Simulation and Gaming Conference. Let's deep dive and hear more about Karthik's life journey from a corporate world to being an entrepreneur. Karthik, welcome to our show.
Good morning. Thank you.
It's great to have you, Karthik, in our show. So Karthik, let's start to go back around 20, 25 years when you started your career. So you cleared actually one of the most toughest exams in the world and got selected in the Indian Institute of Technology, IIT, which is a very prestigious institution in this world. Tell us how it happened and what was your experience studying there?
I grew up in a typical middle class family. Back in the 80s and 90s, India had not opened up to the world. I mean, it was a closed economy. As you know, that India liberalized in the early 90s. So the options available were typically very limited. And it was medical, engineering, chartered accountancy, law, etc. And coming from a family which is conservative, and engineering seemed to be the option out. I mean, if at all, you get it. And it was very competitive and very few good colleges. So it was all hard work, diligence, good company, and you have to attend a lot of coaching classes, etc. And I mean, a combination of hard work as well as luck. Because no matter how hard you try, you just can't get it, right? I mean, there are so many talented people who don't make it. So I would never deny the role of luck or providence.
That's nicely said. And what was your experience studying there?
Well, it was fantastic because I think naturally this is one of the best institutions created by the government. Great learning experience, great company of friends and people who made it the hard way. It was a joyful 4 years, I would say. Mm-hmm. From a academic perspective, from a technology perspective.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. And Karthik, coming back to your corporate journey, right? So you were cruising in your corporate career with 2 decades of experience. And a few years ago, right, you decided to leave it and start your own entrepreneurship journey. So can you tell us about what was your thought process in doing so and then taking such brave decision in your life? And why did you have to go through this?
Well, you mentioned the word cruising in my career. I wouldn't say that. As in, yes, I was doing fairly well. I'm not denying that compared to many others. But then again, as you all know, that beyond a point of time, they call it like the midlife crisis hits people, right? I mean, I was like 15 plus years into my corporate life, in the 15 to 20 year band zone. And that too, IT gets to you after a point of time. On the one side, it got the limelight because it was the rapidly growing industry and all that. So it was in the limelight. Mm-hmm. But then again, the industry itself was drastically changing. And the point is that you start searching for your own value addition, sense of purpose, sense of meaning. You start looking for that. And over the last 3-4 years, I would say 2013 to 2017, I was not inwardly happy, I should call it, right? Although the outward, the job, role, pay, designations, all that was there. Mm. Inwardly, I was not happy and I was seeking something else, but I didn't know what that something was.
Beautiful.
But I didn't see myself in IT for a long time. It was not just because of Cognizant, it was because of IT as a whole itself, right? Because fundamentally, there has to be a sense of contribution and creativity in the work that one does. And there were a lot of youngsters who were doing it well in IT anyway. And then it got to a point in 2016, 2017 that I just couldn't, I would say, manage any longer. I had to do something drastic about it. And as a godsend, providence, whatever you call it, Cognizant announced a voluntary separation plan for directors and above in May 2017. Mm. And that really was a godsend, and I just grabbed it without knowing what to do next. And it took a couple of months for me to figure out what to do next. So that's how it happened.
That's interesting. So you moved from your corporate world job to, you know, starting something of your own. And what I've seen is that a lot of people who venture into startup, they think that they have to learn the tricks of the trade from the scratch. However, there are always opportunities for founders to leverage from the learnings from the corporate world and apply for their startups. With your corporate world experience, are there any particular skills that you applied when you started working on your own?
Yes, definitely there is a lot to leverage and from our experiences. Mm-hmm. Whatever experiences we have had in the corporate world, domain skills, technical skills, most importantly, people management skills, learning from past failures, past successes, everything, right? It's all there with you. And the thing is, as I said, I was in the phase of figuring out what to do next. But back in 2010, 2011, and in Cognizant, I had hit upon an idea, or rather it was not my idea. I had chanced upon an idea, which I was kind of experimenting over the next couple of years as a mm-hmm. hobby, which is related to this game-based learning. And that is something, although I had not played in an official role sense in Cognizant, I was doing it in an informal capacity to actually drive some of the organizational initiatives. Mm-hmm. So that was something on which I had to build in the future. And that was an area of my interest. Obviously, I was not an expert in that area, but I had done enough practices. So I decided to get certified formally in gamification, and I started exploring that path. So that was like something that I leveraged upon my corporate experience.
That is awesome. That is awesome. And when you said certification and formal certification per se, so for our audience, do you have any recommendations for certification on gamification?
Okay. This is something that I did way back in 2017, mm-hmm. but I'm sure there are a lot more options. I'll tell you what I did. It is a certificate in gamification. It's a Coursera course by Professor Kevin Wiebach of Penn State University. It still continues to be popular. Then there are others also available, many others available in Udemy. There are things that Yu Kai Chow, he's offering in Udemy. He's again a gamification guru. There are plenty of them out there. Carl Kapp offers not like a certification, but their courses. Sharon Boller, Carl Kapp, all their courses are amazing in their own way. So these are a couple I can think of.
That's beautiful, Karthik. And that's wonderful to note for the audience in case they want to jump onto the gamification area. And coming back to your startup, you know, your startup is called Let Us Play to Learn. I think the word is beautiful and the sentence itself is so good. Why Let Us Play to Learn, and what problems are you solving through this?
Okay. So this again, I used to call, there's no right word that I could, the industry words were game-based learning and gamification, right? I mean, it continues to be the case. And while that we have to use it in the business context for people to resonate with this idea, fundamentally, there is a play or a fun element that is there in all of us human beings, right? Very I mean, true. That's where it just suddenly occurred to me one morning on April 2018, I would say, right? Play, let's play to learn. It just flashed. I mean, I don't know how, but I thought, let's go with it, right? Earlier, I had experimented with some other names. I mean, I had done with a partner for a short-term stint called Gamification Republic and all that. But again, gamification is again an industry term. So this play somehow appealed to me. Play, let's play to learn. See, what are we all doing lifelong learning, right? Are we learning in the fun and joyful way? I don't think so. At least the conventional form. Yes, there are many forms. I'm not denying that. But by and large, our education, knowledge transfers, learning is very, very boring. it is very conventional. It is lecture-based and it's information intensive, let me put it.
Can't agree more, right? And especially with online learning coming into play and all that, with kids continuously, you know, hooked onto the system, trying to understand what, you know, people are talking all the time. So, you know, we just have to bring that fun and play, as you said, because then it becomes part of the process. They don't feel tired, you know, absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
So is that the problem that you're trying to solve in terms of making learning fun?
Yes.
Beautiful.
And not just that, as we explore further, it's not just for making fun for the sake of it. In fact, I happened to research even further as I explored. There is a lot of scientific papers, research papers published saying that actually games and play augment the learning process.
Mm.
There are scientific results published, both qualitative and quantitative, at all age levels. Usually, games and play, the moment we say, they will say, okay, we are not children. But that's not true. At all ages, people love fun. Whether you are young, old, medium age, whatever it is, we all love to have fun. Just harmless, simple fun, right? I mean, it's...
That's true.
It's just that that's we true. Have notions that we should not have fun. We should not play as we grow old. So
that's true. Yeah.
And what benefits and impact the game-based learning you feel would have on people?
Okay. So, I mean, this again, I'm quoting partly from my experience, partly from the research studies that I have. There are so many benefits. I'll probably quote the top three or four.
That would be good.
Number one, apart from the fun factor or the joy that a game gives you, which is given, it enables an environment which is fail-safe. When I say fail-safe, you don't get judged in play or a game, right? When you play a game, there is no sense of judgment. Am I doing right? What if I go wrong? What if I lose? What if I speak wrongly, etc., right? There is no sense of judgment. And that's something very, very important in a corporate setup. Let's take a meeting, corporate meeting, or let's take a class, school classroom, right? Many of us won't volunteer answering. Even if the teacher is kind or even if the boss is open-minded, to receive any ideas, we will not speak up. Mm-hmm. The reason is, what if we go wrong? What will others think of me? Because there is a societal judgment that we form around us, right? Whereas in a game, the same person will not mind making mistakes. In a game, losing a game, making mistakes is perfectly a part of the gameplay. Whereas in the real world, somehow we have notions that we should be perfect all the time. Right, we can't make mistakes, we can't go wrong. So this is a very, very, very important part of why play and games are needed. The second thing is very closely related to this is, because it provides this joyful and a fail-safe environment, you try to do it again and again. Our mind longs for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because we want to be in protected environments. As human beings, we want to be in environments which are enjoyable, where our failures will be encouraged, and therefore we try to play again. As we try to play, we try to practice the learning. See, finally, practice and expertise and mastery, whatever you call it, comes out of repetition.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, play and games enable an environment for repetition to happen by making it fail-safe, by making it joyful. So it has universal applicability across the board. Now, the third dimension is, I would say, immediate feedback. Typically in corporate world or anywhere else, right? Any formal training, there is this set of training sessions one attends, and or even if it's university education, school education, right? You go through a set of modules or set of classes, and then you are assessed after 1 month or 2 months or whatever at logical points, right? Now, what happens is there is a gap between your learning and the gap between application assessment, right? In a game, you make a wrong move, you immediately get feedback. I'm talking about a learning game. Let's assume you design a learning game.
Yeah.
You make a wrong move, you know why you're losing points. And you make a right move, you get benefits or motivations or points, whatever you call it. And the feedback is immediate. This is extremely crucial. And this is again, fail-safe feedback. Just remember that, because feedback as it is very difficult for humans to handle.
That's true.
And fail-safe feedback is more welcome, and an immediate feedback is even more welcome. So you get all of it in game-based learning.
That's fabulous. That's a very, very good summary.
Yeah. Right. And I think just to add to it is also maybe drive and would make people comfortable doing experiments and yeah. want to try to innovate as well, which in your normal course of life or your course of work, you would shy away from doing it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Everything is, but see, somehow the spirit of curiosity, spirit of exploration gets lost as we age. Mm-hmm. What we see in a child, why is a child, young child, very creative? Because it doesn't worry too much about the world around it, right? Or rather, it has that sense of resilience. And as we grow up, we start judging ourselves. We start perceiving judgments by others. These are all self-imposed curses, right? That we grow up with. And therefore, our creativity dips. We become more formal. We become rigid, and therefore our peak potential doesn't come out.
True. Beautifully said. So, in terms of the real life examples of each of these cohorts that you are trying to solve, if I'm not wrong, you are trying to give gamification concepts to cater to a wide range of customers, right? So, how are you? Can you give us some examples around those?
Sure. Well, I started, let me give a small background of where I started, including my experiments in Cognizant. That's when I first started. We did a knowledge theme park of gamified artifacts way back in 2012. This is for a Fortune 500 insurance customer, where instead of typical PowerPoint presentations, we decorated the base with all insurance games in personal insurance, commercial insurance, life insurance, annuities, everything was gamified. It was made so lovely that it appealed to the junior most software engineer until CXOs. Our client CXOs were bowled away. And that was the first time I realized that this has power. There is something that I need to discover. The second time I did was with a Cognizant manager plus audience, where I was in operations and finance, cost control. It's not a loved job by others, I would say. It's one of the difficult jobs to do, extremely painful jobs to be in.
Yeah.
Nobody likes to be told that you need to cut your budgets, right? I mean, it was hell, actually, driving through the traditional way. So what we did was a bunch of us, we came up with some gamified artifacts to explain people why cost cutting is needed, how your costs are actually being used in a way that is relatable. I mean, move away from PowerPoints. Let's play games around revenues, margin, forecasting. We created a lot of games around revenue management, margins, forecasting, then enabling travel ready visa associates, you name it, all the things in our operations field we gamified. And this was loved by people, managers and above. Like, I'm talking about people with 10 to 15 years plus experience. And in fact, even at the senior most levels, even at the VP, SVP levels, it was really loved. So this, again, I would say that play establishes a sense of connect. Again, rather than sending a mandate, a corporate mandate or a change management mandate with saying that you have to cut costs, you will be held responsible, which is of course needed. I'm not denying that there is value in that too. But an average person, a typical person, it tends to cause more scare and fear as opposed to a sense of connect, which is where these actually help break that and create a healthy relationship. These are not fun. I mean, none of what I do is fun for the sake of it. While fun for the sake of it has its own, is good in itself. This is fun with learning and meaning, is what the way I look at it, right? You apply games and play in the context of learning. So these are the first two experiences. And post my entrepreneurial stint, I had about three things that I would like to quote. One is my first and foremost was creation of a personal finance awareness board game. My last paycheck. Co-designed it with another person, Santosh, who's again a good expert in gamification. It was done for a firm called Funds India. They are a mutual funds firm based out of Chennai. And they were doing workshops to create audience awareness for the general population on various different forms of investing, be it your typical fixed deposits in bank, gold, then you have your real estate. Then how do you make an average common man aware of investment like stocks, mutual funds, etc., right? It's very difficult. Typically, these get done using, PowerPoint presentations, using a lot of data, charts, etc., which is important, but it doesn't have that sense of connect. So Srikanth, who was the co-founder of that firm, was open enough and to try out a new method. He said, why don't you guys create a board game for our workshop? And we created that in about in a couple of weeks' time, and two months, I would say. And we played it out in their workshop. So instead of the traditional workshop where the sessions were given in a form of a formal presentation, Srikanth allowed the audience to play games for the first 1 hour so that they get experiential learning, because the game actually helps you self-discover what will happen if you put it in different forms of investments.
You're making people forcefully think.
Yeah, forcefully think and joyfully think, I would say.
Yeah.
Forcefully, there is a strain there. Joyfully think, I would say.
Good one.
And then that was followed by the formal presentation, of course. That is inevitable. As I said, I never believe that games can replace anything, but they significantly supplement or act as a catalyst for joyful learning. That's the way I look at it.
That's wonderful examples.
And there were two more. We created one for Crux 108. Praveen Shekhar, who's a famous entrepreneur, he's a marketer, and he's very, very open and to newer ideas. He keeps experimenting all the time. He's like a phenomenal guy. He said, why don't we make marketing enjoyable? He's a marketing guru, I would say. He's an outlier marketing guru, Praveen Shekhar. So he said, why don't we create a marketing game? So we started working with his team and started evolving a marketing card game called Maja. He named it Maja. I mean, a very nice name, because marketing jack of all trades. So he wanted to communicate the concepts of what is outlier marketing, what is value addition in marketing, what is referral marketing, what is building your tribe. And he wanted to communicate these concepts, and we tried creating a card game with about 40 stories of real life brands which actually exhibit these marketing strategies. It was designed along the lines of somewhat similar to Rummy card game, which is popular, right? Where you need to form sets. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we created that, and this was launched in TaiCon, the Indus Entrepreneurs Conference last year.
Okay.
So that again was very, very popular, and that was another experience. And then we created one more game for Kelp HR. Kelp HR, they do a lot of initiatives. Their core special initiative was POSH. POSH is Prevention of Sexual Harassment. It's unfortunately a topic which is very important, but again, very difficult to communicate, or probably, I would say, make the audience open up, right? Because it's a very, very sensitive topic. I mean, people are aware, but they don't feel like opening up. So this, again, we needed a tool. I wouldn't call it a game, because this is not a game unlike the other forms, right? This is very difficult to gamify in the traditional sense. So we created an activity toolkit called, it's a card game, but it's called an activity toolkit called What Next. This has a set of prompts, different situations, and what are your responses when harassment happens. So this actually, Kelp HR found it very useful and engaging in their workshops, because it actually prompted people to think along various different situations and come up with matching solutions. It gives a prompt and clue to the audience. Because again, earlier this year, they played it out in their annual conference, POSH conference in Mumbai, and it was received very well by the audience. So these are some 2-3 examples that I could think of.
Yeah, that's really good examples. So moving ahead, Karthik, the only way to predict the future is sometime to create it. And I know that you love learning education ecosystem. Wanted to hear your thoughts on near to medium to long term skills which are required to grow.
Well, I think it's partly based on my experience, plus also based on a lot of authors whom I have read. let me try to combine whatever best I can in the to the best of my memories. One is, they call it the 21st century skills. Let me start with that, which is the four C's: curiosity, collaboration, critical thinking, and communication. These are going to be very, very essential. And these are skills worth inculcating. And many institutions, the traditional educational institutions or the educational forms. So the four C's, they are not a part of our traditional education system, right? Barring a few exceptions. So these are some things that are worth cultivating. I mean, communication is never easy lifelong, right? No, knowing a language is not communication, because communication is that's very extremely important. Then critical thinking, of course, gets developed in some form or the other. Creativity definitely needs to be fed. For that, the continuous sense of curiosity and exploration has to be there lifelong, right? And creativity is a mixture of so many things. And then we talk about collaboration, right? I mean, traditionally, we have grown in a world where we compete with each other right from a young age, grades, marks. Then in the corporations, again, you have ratings, bell curve, and all that, right? That has kind of damaged the overall productivity, if you honestly ask me. Now, suddenly, we can't become collaborative. But increasingly, the interesting thing is that collaboration also, people have started awakening, right? To the fact that you can't do it all alone. A lot of collaborative things that are happening in the world. But again, the percentage of competition far exceeds collaboration. Mm-hmm. That is an opportunity to change. And there's a famous, expansion of the word team, right? Together, everyone achieves more, right? Mm-hmm. So that's exactly what collaboration is all about. But it is not easy. See, as much as we intellectually realize it, right, because we have been programmed from a young age in terms of insecurity, and the world is competitive and therefore I have to be competitive kind of a thing, right? I mean, you have, even in top corporates, you have, I'm the market leader, I'm the second leader, et cetera, et cetera, right? It never goes away.
Yeah.
But collaboration is about realizing what strengths you bring to the table and also acknowledging what strengths others bring to the table, right? If that is an attribute, that clarity is there, then magic can happen. Wherever it is, realizing your own strengths and weaknesses or areas that where you can't perform, and vice versa also. If you're able to blend the two, then that will really result in superior
performance. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
And then there is another completely different dimension which gets ignored in our world of traditional education, which is attributes like empathy. Mm-hmm. And empathy, not just in a human sense, but even in a business sense, I would say. You need empathy. Empathy is a critical ingredient for design thinking. Now, if I say design thinking, people will say, yeah. But what is design thinking all about? The fundamental foundation block is empathy, right?
True. Yeah.
So empathy has to be brought in from a young age. Another thing that is worth cultivating is the growth mindset. Growth mindset is a famous work of Carol Dweck in 2008, Stanford psychologist, if I remember right. She has done some path-breaking work on mindsets, right? Everybody can improve themselves, right? Mm-hmm. We are not born with any weaknesses or strengths. If we choose to, we can improvise ourselves with effort. It's a work worth reading. The best part is you focus on efforts, not the results. We live in a results-focused world, right? Where if you do something, you must get results tomorrow. And the world glorifies you or boos you depending on whether you win or not. So effort happens over a period of time. And with effort and self-belief, everybody can improve. So this is another dimension. Growth mindset, empathy. And then, of course, grit and resilience, right? Mm-hmm. Life is going to knock us all sooner or later. It's just a matter of time. There's never permanent up nor permanent down, right? And it's the downs that we all need to learn how to handle. And I continue to learn even till today how to handle a down period, right? You go through so many downs in your life. And how do you pull yourself up? And how do you develop that resilience, right? How do you keep persisting during downtime? It's great when you're going through a high, right? Life will be blissful and all that. But when you're going through a low, how do you handle that? If that is, I mean, the rest of it is like the top, I would say. When the world talks about AI, ML, analytics, or whatever, right? I mean, these are all, or any other field, these are the technical aspects of it. But the foundation is all about the emotional inner being, right? Which is all about these.
Nicely summarized. Wonderful, Karthik. And how can people reach out to you? I've got so much insights on gamification, about life, the experiences that you have told. So how can people reach out to you? And what are your expectations from the community?
So I'm available. If you see my background, you find that URL http://bit.ly/askp2l. This is a small form that I have created just so that I understand what people are reaching out to me for. So I'll go through it and I'll be able to respond to them. That's the best way to reach out to me. Because a lot of times, that way I understand the context of their reaching out. I can plan out and get back to them. And I'm available on LinkedIn with my full name. They can reach out to me on LinkedIn. I've written a lot of blogs on all the aspects that I covered, both the game-based learning aspects, plus the life skills that we talked about just now, right? There are a lot of articles there. That's another forum where I frequently use LinkedIn. So these are forums by which I can be reached.
What a great episode. Thank you so much, Karthik, for spending time with us today.
I must thank you guys. I mean, you guys are spending time in inviting different people, doing research, preparing this. So I owe you a thanks too.